Welcome, everyone. Welcome to the 2012 Feminist Theory Workshop. This is our sixth annual Feminist Theory Workshop, and I want to welcome especially those who have come to all of them, and I hope you will come to more. Welcome, too, to newcomers, and I hope this will be the first of many for you. As you know, we once again have a very exciting lineup. Our keynote speakers, and I'd appreciate it if you could identify yourselves, and you're all sitting at the front, so that's easy to do. Joanna Hodge, Patricia Williams, Gayatri Spivak, and Letty Volt. And our roundtable participants are Elise Weinbaum, Victoria Hesford, and Lauren Berlant, who's right there in the back. Okay. Our seminar leaders for tomorrow, who you can also put your hands up. If I've already said your name once, you don't have to do it again unless you really would like to. Gayatri Spivak, Wanima Lubiano, who no doubt will be here shortly, Jane Gallup, Elise Weinbaum again, Joanna Hodge, Victoria Hesford, Ara Wilson, at the back, Letty Volt, Diane Nelson, Jolie Olcott, again at the back there, Tyler Curtin, Madeline Detloff, and Robin Wiegman, who founded this Feminist Theory Workshop and organized the first one in 2007, I think, a long time ago now. But I want to start off with the many acknowledgements and thanks to all who helped to put this together. First of all, to the team in Women's Studies, all the faculty in Women's Studies, and the staff in Women's Studies, and I will identify them in a moment. For their financial support, thanks to the following Duke University departments and programs: African and African American Studies, Arts of the Moving Image, Center for International Studies, Cultural Anthropology, the English Department, the Franklin Humanities Institute, the History Department, the Literature Program, the Office of the Dean of Faculty, the Office of the Provost, the Program in the Study of Sexualities and Romance Studies. A huge thanks also goes to our 15 institutional co-sponsors who committed to send students and faculty to the workshop. And those of you who are within a university who have come here through funds offered by the university, who don't find yourselves on this list, could you please tell your institutions that they can, in fact, claim the status of institutional co-sponsor if they just let us know in advance, because that's all it takes. We're really delighted to have universities commit to sending students and faculty here. The Women and Gender and Sexuality program at Harvard University, the Women's and Gender Studies program at UNC Greensboro, Women's and Gender Studies at North Carolina State, Women's and Gender Studies program at Ohio, the Department of Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies at Emory, Women's Studies Department at the University of Michigan, Gender, Women's and Sexuality Studies at the University of Iowa, Women's and Gender Studies at Wake Forest, the Alice Paul Center for Women, Gender and Sexuality at the University of Pennsylvania, Center for the Study of Women and Society, the Graduate Center, City University of New York, Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies at Miami University of Ohio, Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies at Ohio State University. My goodness, can we just call it one with one name, one word, really? All this proliferation, I mean, Center for Gender, Sexuality and Writing, School of English, University of Canterbury, Women and Gender Studies Program, Arizona State, the PhD Program in Feminist Studies and the PhD Program in American Studies, School of Arts and Humanities at the University of Coimbra, Portugal. I also want to acknowledge those who have contributed to the Women's Studies endowments that allow us to supplement the support of the others I've mentioned in putting this on, and also the Office of the Provost, who contributed this year to our fund to bring in non-US-based scholars from around the world. Special welcome to those of you who have come from far away. So I, as always, owe a very, very special thanks to the staff of Women's Studies. Lillian Spiller is your link, I know, to the Feminist Theory Workshop when you're not here, and she really does an amazingly thorough job of putting all the logistics together with grace and hospitality and precision. So she's probably not in the room, but can we give her a round of applause anyway? She tends to go away when she's going to be thanked. And for this year, there is a special reason for it too. She broke her leg a couple of months ago. So that means also that if you do have questions for her, she's very happy to answer them. But if they are questions that involve moving around, could you please ask Maria Elena, Gwen, and Melanie, who are going to be around that table as well. And I want to thank them also. Maria Elena Weitzel has been a wonderful addition to the Women's Studies staff for the last year and a half, and she's contributed greatly to helping this year. And of course, Melanie Mitchell and Gwen Rogers have been invaluable supporters too. I want to thank also the technical staff, and also thank those of you who have already or will be providing transport from one site to another for our speakers. Okay. So last year, a productive tension emerged as Rosalind Morris teased out the distinction between the hereditary filiation and self-limitation as a production of property and the relation to the nation state, and inheritance, which she glossed as involving the problem of the gift, through a reading of Gertrude Stein's Wars I Have Seen and Brucie and Willie. Understanding the refusal of a continuity between name and being, she identified the problem of group identity. For example, those manifest in the nouns woman and Jew and presumed to be part of a hereditary relation of kinship, understood as distinct from one of affiliation. Through readings of Stein's works, problems of terminology and identity that work against Stein's late style, which itself prioritizes a certain suspension in the text of alterity as an education in reading and engagement with otherness, but also that are then employed in critical works, such as biographical writings, that see Stein as not simply complicitous with a certain anti-Semitic collaboration, but actively self-hating and outright racist, much in the way that critics accused Marx of anti-Semitism in his essay on the Jewish question, which was an essay in the background of her talk. Say. Showing how critical work and contemporary thinking remains entangled within the logic of hereditary and kinship, which in a sense binds the logic of war, the genocidal, and the familial, she asks us to consider the problem of generation and in a sense how it stands in contrast very frequently to the generative. One member of the audience, in fact our most loyal Feminist Theory Workshop attendant, Madeleine Detloff, asked the question of whether, in spite of herself and in spite of Stein, Morris made Stein into the good object. How would one address the question of a text like Melanctha in that context? So Morris sought to address what happens in relation to the late work of Stein, even as she acknowledged Richard Wright's embrace of Stein's gerund form. In other words, pointing out the contemporary terms of racism that we read into previous moments as if sometimes necessarily from an apparently enlightened position, and the politics of accusation in contemporary scholarship that disallows sometimes a certain engagement or entering into the text people produce to find their relation to the world and to worlding. In elaborating on what that might mean in terms of the forms of interpolation we live by, and also as a way of demonstrating a commonality with Madeleine's question, She considered the terms lesbian and queer as involving different registers that are perhaps central to the questions of academic feminisms in their manifestation in programs of women's gender, feminist, sexuality, queer, et cetera, studies, with the various hopes and investments announced and perhaps engendered in those terms. She said in Question Time, prefacing her comment by saying that she, in a sense, was going to overstate the case in order for a provocation, that she more easily responded to the interpolation lesbian than queer, because the latter functions in the order of democracy to come, the name of a structure as yet in excess of possible self-universalization that is not to be confused with imagining oneself as the instantiation of a universal. But one exists, of course, with the persistence of ongoing, if slowly shifting, sex-gender systems of gendering that are irreducibly constitutive, even if we seek to surpass them. Another way of putting this is the importance of thinking through the distinction between liberal forms of political emancipation and human emancipation, as articulated in Marx, in criticizing the problems of one form of rights then as dangerous ultimately to human emancipation. There still needs to be a way of dealing with the histories of prejudice, discrimination, and genocidal violence, and indeed, therefore, the protection of those rights, even as they are premised on a liberal notion of freedom from interference. The different levels of sameness and difference, different forms of otherness and alterity we live with within feminist theory, and perhaps feminist scholarship more generally, are possibly its biggest challenge, something that speaks also to the question of politics, how we understand the relation to the political, the empirical, the conceptual, the juridical, and the more generalized sphere of justice. One could say, perhaps, that it's this balance that remains the real challenge of feminist scholarship and theory, and perhaps other politically informed areas of theorizing, to be multiply responsible on a number of levels, as Gayatri Spivak once put it in another context, thought trying to touch the ontic. One could say that form of thinking that touches the ontic is the challenge of the various interfaces of feminist thought, the engagement with the others, the affective state, the interference of one register of thought by another, whether disciplinary interference, supplementary interference, the domestic intruding into the civil and showing it to be anything but that, the non-relation and relation among the political, historical, or tied to the structures of hereditary logic or affiliations. Spivak's closing to Subaltern Studies, Deconstructing Historiography, which was one of the texts that, one of the readings that was put up on the website for you, addresses the formation of a discursive field of the university of the idea of a community as whole within the work of subaltern historians, of which she is a part and in excess at the same time. If the historian, at the end of the essay, of her essay, if the historian and the subaltern share an account of a relationship between the consanguinal and the spatial, it is perhaps at the expense of acknowledging the workings of sexual difference and of sexuality as structural to a notion of community rather than a manifestation within a gender-neutral understanding of it. She ends the essay with citations from Lévi-Strauss and Derrida to elucidate both the manner in which all forms of hereditary are mediated by the incest taboo and thus as centrally and structurally a matter of sexual difference. Also the role of representation as it manifests itself in subject constitution, and thus a matter of gender. The obfuscation of this point could lead to the forms of notions of cultural consciousness, indeed, that we see Leti Volpe addressing in quite different forms in her Framing Cultural Difference essay, in which the logic of a notion of community consciousness, so much in play in current requests for asylum, for example, lead to a kind of genocidal logic such that, for example, in the language of Ayan Hirsi Ali, all murder of Muslim women appears to be the result of Islam in general, playing into, as Volpe puts it, quote, certain narratives that have traction because of already existing scripts about gender, culture, immigration, and Islam. For legal cases, then, when the strategic use of certain essentialisms makes it necessary for anthropologists to misrepresent their own work in any given site in order to support requests for asylum, and Charlie Pio, our colleague, I'm not sure if he's here, has done work on this. They are stuck between a rock and a hard place, asked to produce a genocidal logic and narrative in order to support, for example, asylum cases, such as one could say Hirsi Ali's own. Volp looks to the way in which the understanding of hereditary structures, in a sense, need to be negotiated through the ways in which they come into being through certain property transfers and manifest quite distinctly as soon as we understand the hereditary logic of culture as always built into certain scripts. While the materiality of a problem needs to be addressed, it must be understood for her in the terminology of difference if we are to understand the specific social forces that shape women's lives, in a sense how the mechanisms of inheritance function to continue and discontinue notions of the cultural and their manifestations. She turns to figures like Inderpal Gariwal, for example, who works as an anti-sexist and anti-racist practice, to begin to develop, who have begun already to develop, new forms of framing cultural difference in legal cases, so as to ensure juridically some access to right within the flawed terms to which perhaps we change our relation of inheritance when we conceive of difference. It's this conceiving indifference that I think Patricia Williams addresses in her Alchemical Notes, questioning the wholesale rejection of rights discourse and asserting the need to find a way of addressing the differential relation to rights within a given context. She closes, I keep going to the end of essays, I realize. She closes with the problem category of the family. Quote, in the thicket of those relations of slavery, its reproduction, and its aftermath, quote, the insignificance of family connection was consistently achieved through the suppression of any image of blacks as capable either of being part of the family of white man or of having family of their own. End quote. In other words, a recognition of blacks as kin, as she puts it, needs to be brought about in the legal system in order to be able to understand rights for blacks as, quote, the resurrection of life from 400-year-old ashes, the parthenogenesis of unfertilized hope. End quote. Her notion of kinship then is bound to a new understanding of inheritance, such that they are unshackled from their anthropocentric ties to the sexual, racial, and property distinctions that have named them. She ends, and this ties us back to the Haraway talk from last year, give them to cows, give them to history, give them to rivers and rocks, give to all of society's objects and untouchables the rights of privacy, integrity, and self-assertion. Give them distance and respect, end quote. As if to gesture toward the democracy to come that might ensue with the recognition of the structural contortions of hereditary logic and the possibilities of differential inheritance, the notion of right itself then changes, perhaps to use Spivak's language, through the functional change in a sign system, thus brought about when we understand the syntagm of the semiosis of subalternity. The question of parthenogenesis and the repressed stories of reproduction are played out in Hodges' article, which looks to understand the thinking indifference that philosophical feminism engenders. Women, tradition, generation, descent, and inheritance are terms she employs to question whether there could be an alternative to masculinist notions of patrilinear lines, of filiation, affiliation, and succession. What would it mean to understand a matrilineal if by that we could understand an Irigaray framework of difference? From psychoanalysis, Irigaray draws a notion of the logic of the same in which men and women participate in order to show how woman as difference does not exist. Sexual difference then becomes the site for and of the more than one, the understanding of the material differences crucial to feminism and manifested in what we frequently recognize as men and women in a binary relation that exists within a logic of the same such that woman in difference does not exist. Sexual difference then becomes the possibility of imagining the many, more than one sex, the proliferation of difference and the invention of human relation beyond a generational logic, even as Irigaray and others, indeed Elise Weinbaum, have attended to the repressed story of reproduction in modes of thinking that is species bound and thus instrumentalized through the suppression of racial and sexual difference. Before we get on now with the business of the conference, there are, of course, announcement that I would like to make. I am going to be on leave next year, and so the seventh feminist theory workshop will be run by Anne Allison, who is going to be interim chair of Women's Studies next year.